When you sell on Amazon, you might be wondering what makes your customer choose your product over countless other products on the marketplace. In this video, you will learn how to get insights into customer behavior and preferences so that it helps you to craft your Amazon product listing to match your customer needs. In this video, we will be mentioning also IntelliVai tool, which you can access by following the link in the description of this video.
Hello, Mels. I'm really excited to have you here on Orange Click channel today with me to talk about the strategy how sellers could use customer insights to craft their product listings to get more sales. Before we go into the details, could you first introduce yourself and also let us know what is IntelliVai and how do you work together with Amazon sellers?
Yeah, so first of all, I'm glad to be here. Thank you for inviting me, Lizette. So what we are, my name is Mels, I'm the CEO of IntelliVai, and we are selling on Amazon since 2014. So that's what I have to tell you. So that's where this whole tool set is coming from. So, and a little bit background information, in 2014, I started out because I got an invitation from a guy, and I'm an entrepreneur for years already. And I got an invitation because I had a website in secondhand jewelry. I have actually physical stores in the Netherlands that sell like secondhand jewelry. I was going into the online space, specifically e-commerce. And then I stumbled upon some kind of groups of people. And one of the people actually invited me for a course that was related to Amazon selling. And the numbers that they mentioned was science fiction to me. Like, how can you sell from your basement like $100,000 a month? That's like insane. But there's only one way to find out. I'll just like test it out, right? So I tested out. I just picked a product, like a random product. I looked in my home, what product can I take? And it was in April 2014. Then in September 2014, I had the product. My first sale was happening in September 2014. I had my goal set. If I sell $10,000 worth of goods by the end of the year, it's a good a test case. And I continue. And it was $100,000. And then I set a goal for 2015 of like, well, what if we can do $1 million? It was $2.4 million. So from that moment onwards, we had this crazy ride. And then we crossed the nine-figure mark in 2020. So we did pretty well. But in 2016, we were using a lot of software tools. And we were obsessed with customers and obsessed with data. Because I don't have a background in science, but I'm a very scientific person. So we want to know our customers inside out. I want to know what makes them tick, what makes them click, what makes them buy, what is the consumer behavior part. So we were using some other tools out there that many people probably know of, some A/B testing tools, but it was way too flat. We want to have like much more information and much more in depth. So we consulted like a bunch of OGs in this space who like helping us out with like, how can we get more information about consumers? And then we started making our own tools. And that was like 2017. We made the first prototype, and then 2018, it was finished. And a bunch of friends found out what we were doing. And they said, can we have access to the tool set as well? And that's how we created like a mastermind of like 60, 70 people. And we kept it close to our chest, never shared anything about it. And we used it for years. And this group as a whole, they grew with, well, in an increase of over $1 billion of yearly revenue as a group in total, which was pretty decent. And in 2022, we decided to open up the tool set for more people, like basically a SaaS product that we go sell mainstream. And that's what we started doing. So now we're talking on stage a lot. We have we're basically selling this SaaS service. And what it's doing, what I just mentioned, like we try to tap into the brains of our consumers, want to know them inside out, what makes them tick, click, buy, what are the objections that they might have before buying that we can counter on our listing. So to understand how can we morph a customer into a buyer or a clicker into a buyer. And in order to do that, you need to know your customer and know how to talk to them. And the other background I have is in sales. I've been doing direct sales in my early 20s. And I knew exactly when I go to a customer, I knew exactly what I had to say, how they responded, and knew how to react to that. And that's got me to like a 98% plus conversion rate, which was insane by the products we were selling back in the days. And now we try to apply the same strategy into online, which is working pretty well. And right now we're on a ride of having one of our new brands selling, getting from zero to eight figures in 12 months time with using exactly this. So we use it as a test case, but I'll explain more later. But that's a little bit of background where I come from and what we're doing.
Okay, it sounds really good and definitely very interesting because, yeah, as you mentioned, there are a few ways how to A/B test some things you sellers prepare for their product listings and for the store, but there isn't really a good solution usually how to kind of get into the customer's mind before you even craft your product listing and really even before you start selling. So definitely an interesting topic. I know you prepared some slides for us as well to kind of introduce us the framework and how sellers should think about it. So go ahead, share your slide, and we're ready to hear what you can sell us from your experience.
Yeah, sure. And before I go more in depth, there is actually an interesting story I would like to share with you, and which is a story which is that I learned. It's actually in the Bible, but there's like two people that are building a house, and one of the guys is actually he starts building right away. So he puts like bricks on the sand, and he starts building his house. And by the time he finished and sitting on his porch drinking his beer, he looks at his neighbor that was starting to build a house at the same time, and he cannot find the guy. And then he goes walking by him, and he sees like this big hole. So this guy is digging and digging and digging. He's not building anything, at least what it seems. He asks the guy, "What are you doing?" He says, "I'm digging." "What are you digging for?" He says, "I'm digging for a rock." He doesn't understand. Then a couple of months later, his neighbor's house gets across the soil. So suddenly he's building his house. And then 6 months, 12 months later, he's finished his house. And then a couple of weeks later, the rain comes, and the house of the first guy is actually get to pieces, like the water and the wind, and is taking the house down. But for the second guy, his house is still standing because he's building it on a foundational rock. And that's important to understand, like you have to dig for a rock first. So what is the foundation of your listing? And based on this premise, there's like three Amazon sellers, three types of Amazon sellers. There's the ones that are just doing something and hoping for the best, which we call the ignorant sellers. Then you have the ones that are copy the competition with thinking that they are better, which we call the arrogant sellers. I have to admit, we've been in that category ourselves. We're very arrogant, thinking that we knew what we were doing. But then the third one is actually the one building on a foundation. That's the customer centric and the vigilant sellers. So you have to decide what kind of group you want to be part of. And I would assume like the third one, of course, is the best one to be in. So how are we using this way, this knowledge? Is like we have, we are in the process of launching a single product brand launched this year, and we take it from 0 to 8 figures in 12 months time, which means that in December this year, we want to do $27,500 daily or $850,000 in revenue. And that's because we actually were digging for that rock, and we build this listing and this product based on the foundation. We actually, the funny thing is we created this listing to be as a test case, a living test case. But it was like very early on in the process, we found out there's actually another seller. Our biggest competitor is a guy that's talking on stage a lot as well. So, you know, we don't want to have this public contest. So we said, okay, we keep the product to our chest. As soon as we meet our goals, probably January, February next year, that we take over the bestseller position, then we can share like, hey guys, this was the product. But it's a very competitive niche. It's a product in a niche where if anyone had ever did a course, they know that there's these lists of products. They say these are the no-go products. So anything that's on this list, don't go sell in these categories, oversaturated. You cannot make any money there. Well, it's exactly in one of those categories, super competitive. And our product is on the high end as well. But as you can see in the numbers, like we closed, this is not updated very recently, but over 750 units a day, over $20,000 days that we have here right now. It's even higher. I probably have to update it with the later numbers. We ran into issues as well, like in the beginning, right? So inventory issues, stock issues, and optimization as well. So we didn't do everything right from the start. Some of the insights we only harvested like later down the road, and then you see the sales seriously increase. But anyways, this is how what might happen if you do it correctly, if you really build your listing on a foundation. So how are we doing it? Let me break that down. So we, first of all, knowing your customer, right? Which is one of the most important things. You have to know your customer inside out. And then two, we implement the lost art of selling in a saturated and optimized marketplace. So the lost art of selling is what I said. I have a background in sales, direct sales. And what I was obsessed with was the script that we were telling. Right. And the script was not like one single script. It was like multiple variations, because anytime anyone responded, I knew exactly what to say, how to smile, how to put my facial expressions, because I knew that every type of customer was responding to this specifically. And that's the lost art of selling. So these two things are very important. And if you look to this iceberg thing, everybody is battling above the surface, but actually there's a huge territory to conquer below, right? Above the surface is, you know, all these listings next to each other. You can do it on price. You can make your listing a little bit better than your competition. But if you really dive in and see what really, really drives customers, like pre-purchase and post-purchase experiences, that's something nobody is tapping into. And you can do that, actually, if you do it right. You should. And that's also like the competition below the water surface is much lower, right? And the other analogy you can draw from this, if storm happens, if bad weather happens, it's always above the surface. So above the surface is much more rough than below the surface. There's always like a calm underneath, no matter how hard the wind blows above the water. So it's a safe place to be and a very good place to differentiate yourself. So let me explain. So this is a slide where I have a short video, which is of Jordan Belfort. And anyone that have seen the movie, the Wolf of Wall Street, probably knows the guy. But this guy knows how to sell, right? So let me show this video very quickly. And then we go over some highlights that we found in this.
The key to selling is to find out what are your clients' needs, values. What do they need? Biggest mistake that rookie salesmen make is they try to sell to everybody versus weeding out people who are not interested and only selling to those who are. I want to know what you need. I want to know what you've done in the past. So you ask questions, not any question. I ask pointed questions to identify what type of pens you've used in the past, how much money you have. Now, the pen is like a euphemism for any product, right? By doing that, I can get a good sense of what you're about. And then when I'm done asking my questions, based on what you said to me, this pen is a perfect fit. Let me tell you why.
So what you hear in this video is the keys to selling. And this pen is perfect for you. Let me tell you why. That stands for much more products, right? And what you should know from your customer, what Jordan is mentioning as well, is you have to know who you are selling to. What is your customer type? What is the moment in the customer journey? What is the customer awareness level? Then two, what are your customers' needs, wants, and desires? And in order to get there, you have to ask pointed questions. Like Jordan said, you have to ask pointed questions. And how you can do that is ask the right question to the right audience in the right way, and then you get the right answers, right? And then you have to create a sales pitch and validate it. And the best thing is that you then source and develop products accordingly. But if you already have products that you are selling, I mean, no time wasted, right? You can use this information as well. You might, we've seen it a lot and we do it a lot for customers of ours as well. Take an existing product and actually sell it the right way by just knowing and understanding your customer. And then you sell. And then that's what also the Amazon A9 algorithm wants to see. It wants to see your conversion rate going up, your click-through rate going up. And that's what you can actually do if you do this the right way. So who you're selling to, and here is like the unaware, problem aware, solution aware, and product aware customers. And you can find this stuff if you do a Google search. Very important to understand. And this is coming from Breakthrough Advertising from Eugene Schwartz, which is a book from the 60s. It's one of these marketeers' Bibles, so to speak, right? A book that everyone, it's a must read. Wherever you're selling and wherever you are writing any copy or creating any content in order to sell. And he's mentioning the different stages of a consumer. So someone has a problem, but they are not aware of the problem. So they are unaware customer. Though then you have the problem aware customers, the people they know they have a problem, right? But they don't know about a solution yet. Then they start searching and then it becomes solution aware. And then as soon as they are solution aware, then they become product aware, right? So, and why is this red, the red box around solution aware? Because Amazon consumers are all solution aware customers. You know, that's where the keywords come from. People go to Amazon, not with the problem in their mind. They come with solutions. They already know that the silica specializes a solution for XYZ problem. They already know that diapers is a solution for their baby so they can put a diaper on, right? So that's solution aware customer. That's where people type in keywords. Problem aware people, they go to Amazon, to Google most likely, and type in the problem they have. How can I fix XYZ? You don't go to Amazon with that search term, but you go to Amazon. So in Amazon, you're selling to solution aware customers. But then also there's a different types of online shoppers and the distribution you can find on those on Amazon. And here's a list of things. So, and this is these type of customers you see everywhere in physical shops and in e-commerce stores, everywhere they are the same. There's window shoppers, there's impulse buyers, there's early adopters, then you have the information gatherers, the need-based shoppers, the discount seekers, and the loyal customers. And there's two you can see are in bold. And that's the information gatherers, 40%. And there's the need-based shoppers, 18%. And if you see, like, most Amazon sellers are selling to the need-based shoppers, 18%, which is product-aware customers. And how can I see that? Because most of the sellers that are selling products, they're focusing on the 6, 7, or 8 different features of their product, which is like 1 or 2 features more than the competition. So they think that people actually are ignited or aroused by all those features. Well, in fact, that might not be the case, right? Because the other group that you can see here is the information gatherers, which is 40%. Those people are solution aware, but not product aware, right? So people go to Amazon with a certain search term, but they don't know what they're getting. Like, I just, before this call, I came, I had a phone call with someone that was selling a specific product. He was coming to me like, how can I find those customers? And I was explaining this, you know, you were talking to information gatherers. So whatever problems people might have when they're gathering information, they see solutions. They don't know if that's the right solution. They don't know what is the best solution to choose from. And then in all these solutions, they're looking for products that are answering their questions or answering their objections, right? So you have to step into this type of market much more than this market. And that's where the biggest difference is right now. Like, most sellers focus here. And it's not only happening on the seller level, it's also happening on the manufacturing level. Like, 2 weeks ago, 3 weeks ago, we were in China visiting some of our manufacturers. And I was talking to them like, you know, you have all these new models of product XYZ or the new designs of product XYZ. So can you explain to me why those designs that you say will be good selling products in the US are actually, in your opinion, good selling products? Where do you get the information from? And they were kind of mumbling, yeah, I don't know. You know, we did go to other customers. And their customers, those are other sellers, what I mean, other brand owners. And they picked products that they like. And that's how we define that this product is actually a popular product in the US or in Europe. And I was like, okay, did you ever ask the end consumer? And they were like, no. And that was for me the answer. So they depend on you guys. Like, if you think a design is nice as a seller, that's what's helping manufacturers to decide if a product is good selling or not. But they don't know. They don't know anything, right? And then what happens, and we've had that for one of our own brands and product lines, where we were selling products to 50-year-old people, 50-plus people. And what we were doing, our manufacturers came to us like, hey, we have this product, 6 features, 7 features. Now we have like 8 different features. And we were like, oh, yeah, sure. We need to have more because it's all driven by features. And if we have more features, we can win more customers. And then we were like, wait a minute. What do our customers actually want? And then we started asking customers, like, okay, what is your biggest problem that you're running into? Why would you not buy this specific product? And they were like, I don't understand it. It's too complex. I just want to fix this specific problem, but I don't know. This has so many features and I don't know how to use it. And I'm talking to 50-year-old people. So what we did go to a manufacturer and say, okay, strip everything of the product. We just want to have these 2 basic features. And they were like, you cannot do that. And then you're like not competitive enough and everybody has more features. So please, can you do that? They were like, yes, we can. And we did. And we became a very, well, not the best seller, but one of the best sellers in the industry with multiple products. So this brand became like a top brand in the niche. Why? Because suddenly people understood the products again, right? This was simple. They didn't understand all this mumbo jumbo 7, 6, 7, 8, 9 different features on the product. So that's one example. The other example is, and that's about like for guys, right? The first razor, the first advertising for razors was shave yourself, because back in the days, nobody was shaving themselves. Then the razor was shave yourself. And, but if you look right now for a razor, if you go to the store and see like looking for razors, you have this 5 blade, extra flexible cushions in front and in the back razors, where you can paint the walls, you know, vacuum the carpet, whatever you can do with those freaking things. It's like, it's had nothing to do with shaving yourself. It's getting more and more advanced. Then another company came along and they really listened to the consumers. Like, what is your biggest struggle when you want to shave yourself? And it was like, every time I'm out of razors, I cannot shave myself, right? And I have to go to the store and then I'm like, I don't know what to buy. There's too many options out there. So it doesn't always fit my, you know, whatever, if I buy this blade, it doesn't fit whatever I want to stick it to, right? To my handle. And it's all different. Everything is different. So that company, they changed that. And they say, you know, we're going to fix the biggest problem, which is sending people every month a couple of razor blades. So they always have sharp razors. And that company did that on a subscription model. That was Dollar Shave Club. And Dollar Shave Club became a billion-dollar company like in a very short period of time. So that's what's happening if you listen to consumers. You're not going to do it better than the competition. You do it completely different. But listening to consumers, that's what you can have when you listen to consumers, right? And that's also what I mean here. So information gatherers are the biggest group of people. And you have to talk to those people and learn from those people. What are they looking for? What kind of solutions are there? Is my solution the only one? Are there other solutions as well? Can I steal clicks from those solutions that people now go to my solutions if I know what the buying objections are for the different solutions? Anyway, I can rant for hours about this topic, and we're training. We are making some decent trainings about these topics as well. But it's good to understand this. So you're selling, the majority of your customers are information gatherers. So if you want to catch the click and get the customer into converting, you really have to sell, right? They're rarely comparing all these different features for products unless they are in this 18% group where everybody else is competing against each other, right? So this is definitely something you can tap into. So what are the information gathering customers' needs, wants, and desires? So in order to find out, like Jordan said, you had to ask pointed questions. You ask the right question to the right audience the right way. In order to do that, you have to talk to people in real life. So there are different options you have. Talk to people in real life. So go out on the streets and establish a focus group, right? You can do that. You can hire an expensive market research agency. Probably cost you between $50,000 and $150,000. You can use a tool like IntelliVee, of course. Cost you like $100 to $200 to do it. Or you can come up with any other strategy on your own, but you must find out what makes people click, buy, and be satisfied. Customers are your teachers, right? They are your teachers. If you have your manufacturers become your teachers or your competitors become your teachers, the only thing you can do is like make the same problem and make it slightly better, right? So if you look to this, so what makes people click and buy and be satisfied? Well, satisfaction drivers are kind of easy to find, right? At least for most sellers. So you can analyze customer reviews, which is post-purchase experience. And that's different from what made people click and buy, right? Because that's pre-purchase decision drivers. And finding out buying objections, that's what we call a drab. And drab is a term I've learned from Anthony Robbins back in the days. He has a course about how to sell. And he mentions three different elements: urban, lurban, and drab. What is that? Well, urban are emotional reasons to buy now. Lurban are logical reasons to buy now. And drab are the dominant reasons to avoid buying. And I got intrigued by that, because if you know the dominant reasons why people would avoid buying your certain product type, and you can counter that in your product listing, you have on a subconscious level, you're answering questions that people might have in their gut. They feel they have some questions. It's not on their in their consciousness yet. But if you address those questions and immediately answer the question as well, you build significant trust. And that's what I've had in doing direct sales in the past. We had these things like, you might think X, Y, Z. And they were like, yeah, I think that. Yeah, now you mentioned that sounds logical. That are those drab items. So they didn't even ask it yet, but I knew many people had those problems. So I addressed it. And by addressing it and then saying, I get you covered, you become extremely smart in the eyes of your consumer, but also you're building a lot of trust. And that's if you have these, and that's resulting in a yes, I get it. Yes. If you have three yeses in a row, people look no further, they buy your product, right? So that's why this is important. The difference between this customer review analysis, which is post-purchase experiences, is huge. I mean, a post-purchase experience is different from a pre-purchase decision driver. Pre-purchase is before someone purchases, they have some rationale going in their mind. If they bought a product, it's like, am I satisfied or not? Right. So for one example, if someone is buying a coffee grinder and they have a very small kitchen, their pre-purchase decision driver is I need to have a small one because my kitchen is small. But you cannot find that in the reviews. Right. Nobody is mentioning in the reviews, I was looking for a small one. No, for them, it was obvious that it should be a small one. So they were ignoring all the bigger ones in the beginning. But for you as a seller, it's super important to know like how many people are looking for a big one versus a small one. Right. Other things that we might find out, like I want to be able to adjust the grind, right? Or I just want to have a very simple one, a plain one. Different type of customers have different drivers, and you cannot find all this from the customer reviews. So customer reviews, you must see them, you must watch them, must study them. But on top of that, you need to have these pre-purchase decision drivers as well. So how can you do this without talking to potential customers? You can't, in my opinion, you cannot, right? Most sellers simply copy the good, bad, and ugly of their competition at best, and make the product more shiny. And well, there's, this is not my set. This is The Big Short is a very interesting movie. I watched it 4 times. I love it. But there's a sentence in there about some financial products. And they mentioned it's dog shit wrapped in cat shit. Sorry for my wordings, but that might be what you end up with, right? You just make the same mistakes as every other seller. You just make it a little bit more shiny. Well, that's not selling, right? What if you can make that and do that completely different and really tap into the brains of your consumers? And that's how this framework works. So this is the scientific method. It's not my image. I stole it. But this is a framework, and it is the scientific method, which is ideate, hypothesize, test, and validate. And if you look here, so it always starts with asking a question, doing research, come up with a hypothesis, and then test and experiment. And then you analyze the results. It's either true or false. If it's false, you go back with another hypothesis and you test that in a safe environment, right? So how you can do that, like asking questions, doing research, hypothesis. Many people that are doing any type of split testing, any type of Amazon experiments, they start here. They say, you know, let me just change my image slightly better. My competitor is doing this, putting this on there. Let me do the same thing and test it out and see if it works better. Well, that's just driving blind. It's just copying something from someone else. You have to start with asking questions, doing research, and then coming up with a hypothesis based on what consumers told you, right? Customers are your teachers. So that's how this framework works. And I'll come with some explanations of what kind of questions you can ask later. But this is how the process looks. So first of all, like, here's the creative variation. So many sellers, they do testing. They start here, create variations, test and validate, and then create their listing images and video accordingly. But if you ask a question you analyze answers, the first things you want to know, what are customers' objections? What are the pre-purchase drivers? What are the consumer preferences? If you know that, then you can brainstorm about hypotheses. And then you want to know, like, how can I win the click? How can I convert and persuade in order to sell? And persuade, there's actually a book written, Persuasion, Robert Cialdini. It's a must read. You can find a very short video online about persuasion. Look it up, and it will explain you more about how to create images and how to get clicks and how to get sales. It has nothing to do with e-commerce, but the methodology is very interesting. So watch that. And then how to counter the objections. And that's how you come up with a listing, the product or listing or product theme. And a theme is not the colors and stuff. The theme is what kind of message do you want to get across? What is your sales message, right? And your sales message usually is something that if you sit next to someone and you try to explain them why they should buy your product over your competition, that's the things you're selling, right? That's the things you're telling them, that they say, oh yeah, let me get a product. What does it cost? If you get that question, you should have that message also in translated into e-commerce, right? That's how selling is done. And the questions you can ask, like some of the questions that you can ask, very important question. And here you see a guy, you know, talking to someone like a lady on the street. And you see there's an older lady and she has a lot of stuff to do. So she's like walking down the street, doesn't have time. But anyway, if you find the people that want to listen, then one of the questions you can ask is, why would you not buy this specific product? Right? Understand, you have to talk to the right audience. So this is a right question. You have to ask the right audience as well. Why would you not buy this product? Why do you want to know that? Because if you know why they would not buy a product, that is getting, so they have to ask that question to their subconscious mind. Like, why would I not buy this product? That's how you can tap into this subconscious objections that I might have. If you know that and you ask 100 people, and you might end up like 20 people saying you the same thing, telling you the same thing. You can conclude that the majority of customers coming to your listing and coming on Amazon have the same type of problem, right? Then the next question you can ask is, if you were looking for a solution for, and then you state the problem, what would be important for you? Just that open question, what would be important for you? So you don't show them a product, you just ask them like, hey, if you were looking for a solution for a certain problem, what would be important for you? And then they start talking like, hey, the product should have XYZ, or it should be easy to take off, or easy to replace, or easy to install if it's a DIY product, or easy to use, or have good explanation, or whatever. And you might think like, oh, I can come up with that like by my own. Well, you would be amazed if you do this. Just do it and pick a few people out of your neighborhood that don't know what kind of product you're selling and just ask them those questions. You will hear things you never had running in your mind before. Then another option is, you show your product listing next to 3 to 6 competitors, and you ask, which of these products would you buy and why? Of course, also after you stated the problem, you know, you have the solution for the problem. And I was like, okay, if this was your problem and you were looking for solution, these were the solutions available. Which of these products would you buy and why? And next to that is, okay, you show the same products and you ask like, which of these products would you not buy and why? And then you get some reasoning from the people like, oh, you know, I would buy this. This is what I would like because yeah, it has this feature and that actually is what intrigues me or what empowers me, or this is climate friendly, or it is natural ingredients or whatever, right? So you get those answers. And that's what's helping you to understand your customers way better. And of course, in IntelliFi, we got it all covered, but that's if you want to do it by yourself, this is the way that you can do it. We ask exactly the same type of questions. But you have to keep in mind, before asking a question, you need to frame the people to become solution-aware customers. So how do you state that is also important, right? You have to paint the picture because maybe those people don't have the problem in real life. So you have to tell them like, okay, if you were in a problem XYZ and you were looking for a solution that looked like, and you mentioned like your kind of category you're selling in, and then you showed them the product, like if these products were presented to you, which one would you buy and why? So framing the people is very important. And we did this with the help of, we're working with a PhD of the University of Washington, who's helping us out there. He's a PhD, human psychology. He's lecturing on university. This guy is one of our rock star educators on these topics. And then we have like a majority of market research specialists that have like similar degrees that are helping us like, okay, how can you ask the right question to get to the answer? How do you interpret those answers to get to certain conclusions? Right. So this is what you can do by your own. And once you know all that, right? So if you have all that information and you've written it down and you saw certain themes and certain patterns, then you start creating your sales pitch and validating it. And here is a video of some guys that are doing it. This actually watch the video and let it speak for itself.
So I wanted to prove that all marketing was the same thing. No matter what you were selling, it was always the same thing, right? And good marketing talked about the buyer and bad marketing talked about the seller. Make sense? I versus you, right? So to illustrate my point, I wanted to prove that what the homeless do and what Microsoft does is the same thing. So if you think about what the homeless do, there is advertising. They sit there with a little sign that says, I'm homeless, I'm hungry, I got 6 kids, I'm a veteran, like whatever, trying to appeal to everybody. That's a little billboard, right? Microsoft has a billboard that says more memory, bigger screen, all the rest of it, right? More RAM, more ROM, right? And what the homeless are selling is goodwill. So if you walk past a homeless person and you put money in their cup, you feel good. If you give them nothing, you either feel nothing or feel bad. You paid for that feeling. There's an exchange of consideration. I sold you goodwill, you paid for it, you got it, right? They're selling goodwill, that's what they're doing. They're selling the feeling of goodwill. So I found a homeless person who was willing to help me, and her sign was pretty typical, and I found out that she makes between $20 and $30 a day selling goodwill, and she works an 8 to 10 hour day, right? $30 is considered a good day, right? Selling goodwill. And like I said, her sign was pretty typical. So I asked her if I could change her sign, and we did. And the sign that I gave her, she made $40 in 2 hours. The sign that I gave her said, if you only give once a month, please think of me next time. It wasn't about the seller, it was about the giver. What are the reasons people say they don't give? How do I know that they're genuine? I can't give to everyone. So I simply answered the questions. If you only give once a month, please think of me next time. I know you can't give to everybody. I'm legit. That's all.
So this video explains about like what marketing is, right? And what good selling is. And good selling is about the buyer. That's what you just saw. It's not the seller or the product. It's about the buyer. A message is everything, right? The way that you present the message can be the same type of message in a different way that presented is day and night and day difference. You have to perfectly use customers' values, fears, and objections in order to craft your message, right? You have to understand your customer. So you saw that, like how that was done in that previous video. And if you know what the values are of people, if you know what the fears are, the objections are, I cannot help everyone in this world. Well, you don't have to help anyone. I understand you, right? So if you just want to help one person, this is how you can do it. Think of me next time. That's how you tap into values, fears, and objections. And then you see, well, the response rate can be as staggering as you just saw with someone that's begging on the streets. Most listings on Amazon are, and you know, I hope your listing is not one of them, but just showing people 50 angles of my product. And that's more like, let me show you how great I am, right? That famous sentence. Well, people don't care, right? And then it's about feature. And it's only focusing on the 18% of the audience. Remember a few slides back, 40% of people versus the 18%, which is the information gatherers is 40%. You want to focus on those and not on the feature 18% of customers. Everybody's doing that. It's too crowded, right? Go into this dollar type of market. It's not telling a story. Most Amazon listings are not telling a story. It's just it's all like keyword driven. And it's important, right? Have the right keywords in order to have the algorithm detect your listing and to rank you to the top of search. But at the same time, you need to tell a story, right? And what is the best way to tell a story is your images. Amazon customers are watching images way more than they read text. Like even if you go on mobile, your bullet points, many times you have to go scroll down, or even half of them are actually, you have to expand it in order to read them, right? So telling a story, if you have your images and your image tag is telling a certain story, that's what you want to do. That's what you need to do. And I see so many listings out there that just show like these 50 different angles of my product. Well, you don't want that. Like, tell a story. Many listings are not engaging with the buyer. And that's not weird, because every listing is copied from another listing, right? There's only very few listings doing this very well. And engaging with the buyer is very important to get and build this rapport. You need to show them that you understand them. We do this in videos, and we have several very interesting in videos. We have like the entire category and multiple categories. The video is at the end. Like, you have your image tag and then you scroll through it, and then the last one is the video. We have videos that are like so well converting that Amazon put the video at the second. So you have first main image, the second, if you scroll, boom, there's the video. We don't know how it happened. We're the only one in certain categories that have that, but it's because we are telling an engaging story and we have a very high view rate of the videos. And well, I can talk for hours about how to make right videos and correct videos, but we do this because we know what customers want and what makes them click, tick, and buy. We know their fears, their values, their objections. So that's how we can utilize that in videos. And most Amazon listings are not taking away objections at all, right? Not, they don't focus on it at all. So example of telling a story. So this is a very interesting short video. It doesn't have, well, it has sound, but doesn't matter. So I can play it anyways. But this, look what happens here. So here you see like the rare of a guy. And this is telling a story in a way with images. Let me just show you. I think you got like, if you saw the hands beforehand, it was just hands, right? So what you saw right now is because first you saw the rare of a guy. Now these hands look like you were looking to the naked ass of a guy that with water over it. And that was the intention of this Gebrit. But I do several very interesting things here. So they tell you a story in a story. So they are associating washing of hands with a fountain in a, what is it, like a toilet. Right. So, and there's an interesting story. So I had once I was at a birthday party of my, my sister-in-law, and then her boyfriend came in, by the time boyfriend. And she asked him, did you wash your hands? So he came from the toilet. Did you wash your hands? And he was like, yeah. And she was like, yeah, but there was no towel. And so how did you do it? Like, there was no towel in the toilet. And he was like red. Like, it was like 30, 40 people in the room, and he was like embarrassed right in front of everyone. So that's how you see, if you don't wash your hands when you go to the toilet, that's embarrassment, right? I hope most people do that. So that's what the association that they make here as well. So that's what everybody does. So here you should do the same thing. If you go to the toilet, you have this fountain in the toilet. So that's an association that they make, which is telling a story in 5 to 10 seconds, you have the message. You don't read anything. You just have the message. This is what the product is, and you see the toilet. You know exactly what it is. That's how you can tell a story with pictures and also with video. So, what is the essence of selling? Like, the first thing that I want to mention is the transfer of emotion, which is the most important thing. And the most important emotion to transfer is certainty. right? Certainty that your product is solving the problem of the consumer, and certainty that people pick the right product from the marketplace full of noise, right? And there are shortcuts, of course. You know, the if some listings have like 40, 50, 60,000 reviews, that is for customers, okay, that I can be certain if it's a 4.5 stars, 60,000 reviews, that this product is good, right? That's why reviews work so well. It's a shortcut to certainty. But at the same time, like more and more listings get more and more reviews. And you know that if 2,000 reviews versus 50, 40,000 reviews is not that much of a difference at all. So if you rely on these high review modes, and you've seen the latest changes and the tests that Amazon have been doing with taking away the total review counts, and because they know also the impact is way too high. People have too much certainty based on reviews. Amazon wants to fix that problem, so you better be prepared. So how to sell the right way? So good marketing talks about the buyer. Bad marketing talks about the seller. We've heard it in one of the videos. Then the bad thing is I'm good because, and then people mention like feature 1, 2, 3, patent X, blah, blah, blah. That's not what people like to read, right? If you can write listings like this, and I'm not telling you that you have to write it in the copy, but it has to be the theme of your image deck, for example, or the theme from your title, image deck, and video. Most people have problem. Like you can relate, like, oh, you have this problem. Most likely you have this problem. That's why you came to our product. For solutions, take note of, and then you mentioned some objections, like objections people might have. And then you might think, and that comes an underlying fear, that if you have this problem, that XYZ is bad for you, and that's good. So you actually, you ignite that feeling in their mind. It's like, yeah, I can relate to that. I wonder what you're going to say. And then you say, well, that's good that you have that feeling. You're a smart buyer, right? And therefore, here is product XYZ, your product, that took into consideration, and you can counter-insulate the objections right there. So that's a perfect example of how you sell the right way. The question is, how do you do that in your listing? Well, that's where creativity comes into play, right? You have to understand this first, know what the objections are, and then get into creative mode. So how do you do that? Well, you have, what I said, talk to the right audience, find the audience with specific characteristics, craft questions, frame people the right way, listen. And of course, IntelliVee has this all covered. We have one platform ready at your fingertip. We have 28 million US-based shoppers. We have pre-crafted campaigns that get all of this done. We have specific frameworks, exactly following the lines that I just mentioned. So this might be a shortcut for you. But you know, whatever you do, go on the market, go on the street, do whatever you need to do to get this information. It will cost you, right? Even in IntelliVee, if you want to do it right, it will cost you between $500 to $1,500 per product, right? If you do a hire a market research agency, it costs you way more. And you know, the thing is that big companies, every company does this, right? If you go to the Procter & Gamble's of this world, the Unilever's, they all have teams to do that. They have their audiences to do that. They have this sensory profiling. People invite them to their offices. They smell, they taste, they do whatever, and they just watch them and ask them questions. Like, you can go as far as you want to. So it will cost you. But you know, at the same time, for this product, what we did with the investment that we took into just market research was $2,340 in total cost, right? So you might say, well, that's a lot. Yeah, of course. But that's the difference. Like right now we're selling over 750 to 800 units a day for this product. We would never have that without this investment, right? And you know, I also have to say, well, maybe you say like, well, 2,340 is not that much. Well, it does not include the hours that we spend on brainstorming, right? The brain power needed to consume the information, the truckload of creativity we put into the project to translate this information into a certain message. So this is a skill you have to develop. Like, same as PPC, everybody's like, give me a course on PPC and I'll do it. And you spend like 2-3 days on PPC courses and then you start doing it on your own. You manage them every single day. Well, this market research part have to have the same place, right? This is the most important thing that you have to master in order to sell the right way. So don't underestimate, don't think this is like a quick fix. I don't have a silver bullet for you. Big companies spend big bucks on this and they are very successful. Like there's no single $1 billion company in this world that did not listen to the consumers. In fact, if you go to, if you check like what a success of Facebook was, Facebook came later than MySpace. What did Facebook do better than MySpace? They listen to their consumers. So right now they are a multiple like $1 trillion company and MySpace is gone, like nowhere to be found. So that's the difference, right? I'm not talking about the small difference. I'm talking about this is a skill set you have to master. And then simple impact calculator. So here are some numbers, right? So just bear with me. It's one of the last slides, so we're done pretty quickly. So if you right now have a certain sales, so you sell 79 units per day, right? It's not too much. It's not too little. It's pretty decent. 79 units a day. Your conversion rate is 15%, right? Your click-through rate, 2.1%. You can find that data in your brand analytics and your SQP data. So you can find the data. So that means that you have 525 sessions, 25,000 impressions. You know, that's where the CTR comes from. So, and then you come up with like 79 units a day. It's a $15 product with a 20% profit margin. So technically, the margin per month you're making right now is $7,087.50. So consider this. If you do this right and you do your market research correctly and you go from 2.1% CTR to 2.6% CTR, it's not massive change, right? We've seen way more than this. But you go from 2.1 to 2.6% CTR because your main image and your title are much better aligned. You really tap into something that people want to see. So your CTR increases. Then your CVR, because the rest of your image is also improved, goes from 15 to 18%. So what happens? Like nothing else changes, right? Your keyword rank doesn't change. Your impressions don't change. But your sessions do increase because now suddenly you have more sessions because of 2.1 to 2.6 CTR. What happens to your unit count? You go from 79 units a day to 170 units a day. That means that you go from a margin per month, 7,000 to 10,000. That's a $3,000 difference per month, per year, 41,310. And guess what happens? If this happens, you go from these numbers to these numbers, what happens? Amazon will reward you with a higher keyword rank, right? Giving you more traffic because suddenly your listing is converting better. So without you doing anything, spending any extra dime on PPC or wherever, what will happen automatically is that your impressions will go up, right? And then, of course, these numbers are still up. So that means that in total, go back to the bottom, $91,854 extra in a year in margin. I'm not talking about revenue. I'm talking about margin here, right? 20% margin. So in order to get that, right, what investment would be valuable for you to say, hey, I want to have like these numbers? And of course, you can make a sheet like this for yourself. You can put in whatever numbers you're selling. If it's 15, if it's 250, it doesn't matter. Do the calculation and the numbers will shock you, right? If you have slight increase in CTR and CVR, the main most important things to focus on, what will happen in the end, right? So may it cost you some money, right? Is it worth your time to invest in this? And what if this happens across all of your products? Like one of my friends, he's a very close friend in one of our mastermind that we're running. In 1 year, without launching a single extra product, did go from 12 million to 25 million in revenue without launching an extra single product, just by doing this the right way, right? So that's the impact. So I'm not talking, this is not hypothetically, this is what is happening right now in the market. Anyway, I think we're at the end of the presentation. Lizette, maybe you have a few questions. And by the way, you have a QR code. If you scan that, you go to IntelliV and have some more information right there. And we're there to help you. But Lizette, you have some questions or some clarification that I can add.
All right. Thank you so much, Mels, for very interesting presentation and introducing the framework of how sellers should think about gathering customer insight and just get the main, actually very core information to even put together the listing or even maybe finalize their product idea. So I think I wanted to ask as a first question, if sellers are now in the process of, let's say they want to launch new products, maybe they already have some ideas, maybe with some of the ideas they have already went to the sourcing process, so they're kind of finding a manufacturer. I wanted to ask, when is like the best time, or when would you usually start using this framework for a product idea? Is it already when you have, let's say you have maybe out of like, I don't know, 10 ideas, you have picked like two that are most potential, and then you go through the same framework for both to understand really if you can go to the market and dominate there, or where would you use it?
Very good question. So what we normally do, so there's different angles you can take. What we normally try to do now, but we do this for 5 years already, right? So we take this process as early on in the development process as possible. So before we start talking to manufacturers, we want to know what kind of product features are there. How can we make a differentiator, right? Sometimes it's a fabric of a product. So let's say you have a shower curtain and every shower curtain is plastic. And I want to know like, hey, what if I make mine of like some kind of sustainable, bio-friendly, eco-friendly solution? Is that something people would be interested in, right? I do campaigns for that. I do market research. If people say, yeah, I would pay more if it's eco-friendly, then I know, boom, home run. And then I'm starting sourcing those products with those fabrics, right? I cannot do the other way around. So that's an example. Like I can, if I don't know it, I can start sourcing my biodegradable products. But then there might be serious concerns that people have. Like, yeah, but you know, shower curtain. What if after a week it's like completely gone because it was biodegradable? Like, I need to address those concerns. Maybe people don't like it at all. So I want to know that before I start sourcing. But it's also sometimes different that we say we have like different products, and it depends like what kind of products can we get our hands on, because we notice certain prices, and then maybe we did some market research of like what kind of prices are people willing to pay. If people are not willing to pay more than $15 for a certain product, the best way for me is to buy as cheap as possible, because price definitely is a driver. How can I get the highest quality for the lowest price? And it also comes down to features. Are all the features that everybody's offering most important? Are they very important? What if I make if I take away a few features? Product gets cheaper, so I can make more margin for the same price, right? So the best way is to do it as early on in the process as possible. But I can understand a lot of viewers, they didn't do it yet and they are in the process of launching products. You know, you can do it later as well. I mean, we are helping a lot of sellers, and then we say it's better to do it because sometimes you say, I have a current product, it has a downside, but if I can address the downside, sometimes that's a USP, because we found out that that's also possible. Like if you don't have something that others do have, what if you have a way to slightly bash all the people that have that because it's costing more? That's why yours is a little bit cheaper, because you don't have it, because you found out most people don't like that. And people are like, yeah, no, I actually don't need it, right? So there's always a way to work by it. And I have to admit as well, sometimes we come and find products that we say, well, you know, based on the research, stop doing it. Stop sourcing the product because you're wasting money and time. Right. You cannot sell this product in this market. So
okay. Very good. Okay, very good. Thanks, yeah, for explaining. And one more question. Do you use any insights trades from Amazon, from Seller Central, from any brand owner's tool when you are kind of putting together this pre-purchase behavior profile of your potential customers?
If we have that information, yes, but many times you don't. If you're already selling the product, you know what the customer demographics are, you know what kind of age the people are, and then we use that. There are some loopholes to find that information via different tools, but they were more for the tech savvy. They know it anyways. But that's what you can do. What you also can do is go to ChatGPT and simply type in, hey, what is the customer demographics for this product type, right? And then ChatGPT will come out. It's across all ages. Or they say, well, it's family situation. People usually with small children, or it's women aged 35 to 45 or something like that. ChatGPT is pretty accurate. They have so much data from around the world, so they know. So that helps as well. But yeah, whatever you can get your hands on before doing this draft campaign, the better. Yeah.
Okay, sounds good. So before we go, could you once more give us a short overview? What's the main solution you offer to Amazon sellers, and why they should use what you offer to them?
Well, basically, this is what we teach. So we have a tool set built exactly around this. So we want to have this solution. There was nothing out there. We did it the hard way. We did go out in the streets talking to people. And then we found out after having talked to 50 people, if you go to them again with the same question, that didn't work out because then they got biased into certain solutions. We tried talking to our own consumers, which was, they were completely biased towards our brand. So then we have to take off the branding. So that's why we said, I want to have an automated system, at least as automated as possible. And it's a simulated marketplace, a simulated environment. And that's what we call IntelliV. So yeah, we live and breathe by this. So IntelliV is the solution, the one-stop shop where you can do it as cheap as possible and as quick as possible. Because that's what we say, rapid microtesting, we want to test as quickly as possible. We don't want to wait like 2-3 months for data. If I test something, I want to have it in 24 hours and then the next step 24 hours later. So that's how you can quickly iterate. Because speed in this world is like everything, right? Especially in e-commerce, you want to move fast. Time is money.
Exactly. Golden words to the end of this interview. So thanks again, Mels, for joining me today and for introducing the framework, but also IntelliV. Wish you all the best, and I also hope to see you soon again.
It was a pleasure. Thank you.
I hope you enjoyed this video and you got some understanding how you could get insights about your customers. And if you want to try IntelliV tool, you will find the link below in the description. And if you enjoyed this video, don't forget to click like and subscribe to our channel. And now I would like to invite you to watch other video about IntelliV. It's a presentation of their tool, and you can see how it works and how you could use in your Amazon business. Check this out.